This is the first lecture of part of three, the first lecture of three regarding partial factor method. At the end of this video, you will understand that the essential part of the method is that the theoretical probability of exceeding a limit state during the design working life of a concrete structure is accepted. We will start with an overview of the structural Eurocodes, then talk about the fundamentals of the design of structures in reinforced concrete. We will have a word on the partial safety factors of loads and materials, and we will say something about the geometry of structures. Structural Eurocodes are a set of harmonized European standards for the design of buildings and civil engineering structures. This course is based upon the following code, Eurocode 2, Part 1.1 of 2005, and its Belgium Annex of 2010. There are 10 structural Eurocodes. In this course, we will focus on Eurocode 0, 1, and 2. Eurocode 0 is the basis of structural design, 1 is regarding the actions on the structures, and 2 is about the design of concrete structures. Next, we will talk about the fundamentals of the design of structures in reinforced concrete. There are, in fact, two calculation methods for reinforced concrete. It's about an elastic design or about limit state design. Elastic design, or you can say it's a method of acceptable stresses. And it goes as follows. You have a force, you convert the force into bending moment, normal force, torsion, and shear force. And from there on, you calculate the stresses and the shear stress, and you compare it with a limiting factor. This limiting factor is a figure that you derive from tests, and you divide it by a coefficient, which we call safety factor. If you take the x-axis, you have the force. With a structural analysis, you derive the bending moments, normal force, and so on. Then you do a design calculation, and you have stresses, and you compare it with the resisting stresses. Now, this method of working, it's straightforward, but it has some shortcomings. For instance, the factor S is not really a safety factor, because it is only a value or a figure where you multiply or where you divide the resistance force that you have found within some tests that you have done. But it doesn't say anything about the real structure, how the real structure will behave, how the material will behave in reality. It is also that when the applied forces increase, the stresses on the structure, it is not necessary that they increase in the same order of magnitude. So it's a little bit unsafe to talk about a safety factor. It's only a factor where you make the resistance that you have with tests, you make it a little bit less so that you feel safer, but it is not a real safety factor. Then the failure load with this method is not known. The only thing that you know is the structure is okay, but you cannot say at this certain load, the structure will collapse. That you cannot say. So you cannot have an economical design. Then there is no distinction between failure and use of the structure. This has a reflection on the economical design too, because sometimes it is important that, no, not sometimes, it's always important that your structure is not failing, but sometimes the use is also has a huge influence on the dimension of the structure. For instance, for the use, it will be something like deflection. the failure, that is when the structure comes down. It's obvious that the use plays a role, but not always. Sometimes the use of the building can be treated differently. So this method does not take into account this, the real safety factor, the failure of the failure load, and makes no distinction between failure and use. So that's why limit state design approach is used. And a limit state means the states beyond which a structure no longer fulfills the relevant design criteria. The ultimate limit state, these are states associated with collapse or with other similar forms of structural failure. So it means failure of material. The serviceability limit states, these are states that correspond to conditions beyond which specified service requirements for a structure or structural member are no longer met. This can be crack formation or deflection or degradation or vibrations can also be a serviceability limit state. The design working life is the assumed period of which a structure or part of it is to be used for its intended purpose with anticipated maintenance, but not without major repair being necessary. You have some five design working life categories depending on their design working life, going from 10 to 100 years. And so you can see that, for instance, for bridges or for very large buildings, very important buildings, the design working life category is 5, and we talk about a design working life of 100 years. The normal buildings, just buildings like offices and your home, your house, has a design working life of 50 years. Then we have something that we call consequence classes, because now you have different buildings, and when a building A collapses, for instance, a stable, when a stable on a farm collapses, it's not that serious. You have some damage, but there's no life in danger. If you have a large apartment building or office building that collapses, the consequences are bigger. Or if a dam, a huge dam, is failing, then the consequences are really, really important. So your design procedure must take care of the consequence, of the consequences of failure. That's why we have three consequence classes: low, medium, and high. Simple as that. So a normal building has a consequence class of 2. The lower buildings, lower consequence class is for agricultural buildings, and the higher one is, for instance, for nuclear power stations, for instance, or for big buildings where a lot of people are gathering, or for firemen, a station for firemen can also be a consequence class 3. Together with the consequence classes, we have the reliability classes. And there is an index, beta, the reliability index. And if you take the reliability index with a reference period of 1 year or 50 years, then you have the different values corresponding to the different consequence classes. When you want to change from consequence class two, for instance, and you want to make it more safer, then you multiply your loads by 1.1 to achieve a reliability class 3 or a consequence class 3. So we learned that the probability of a building collapsing is not zero. Now, the probability is more or less 10 to the power minus beta, with beta the reliability index. It's just a rule of thumb, easy to remember. But the exact of the proper table where there is the connection between reliability index and probability index is this table. And then those two are connected, but this is easy to remember it like that. Now, let's try to explain something about this method. We start, for instance, with a difference between a return period and a reference period. The return period is the average time between two successive characteristic values. The relation between the return period and the reference period with a probability P is given by this classic formula of statistics. It means, in fact, that if you take, for instance, a characteristic value and we talk about the reference period of 50 years, just for buildings, characteristic value of loads, and just for buildings, then we see that the return period is 975 years or 1,000 years. So just to give you an idea, when I'm going to calculate the slab in your living room, and I say that the load, the overload on your slab is 200 kilograms per square meter, and this is a characteristic value, and I'll use it in my calculations as a characteristic value, it means that this load has a return period of 1,000 years. If you now compare it, for instance, with bridges, you have a characteristic value and with a probability of 5% or 95% exceeding, and the return period now for bridges is 100 years, then you arrive at a return period of 2,000 years. Now we will give you an example now to have more feeling about the fundamentals of the design method. Take, for instance, just a building, and this is in design category 4. The design working life is 50 years. The reliability class is 2. The consequence class is 2. And so the probability of failure is 2.9 10 to the minus 4. So this means that if you take the total number of buildings in Belgium 2015, it's something like 3.7 million buildings. Or you can say that 1,071 buildings will fail during the working life of 50 years. Or yearly, 4 buildings will fail in Belgium, just because of the design method that you are using. You can I can explain it more easily or more direct by means of a graph. You will see on the y-axis the relative frequency. And now, when you have an resisting force, for instance, the compressive force of concrete, then you have a mean value. If you take a lot of tests and you have a standard deviation and you have a distribution looking like that. The total probability below this graph is 1. Now, on the other hand, you have the solicitation, the loads. And for the loads, it's also you have a mean and you have a standard deviation and you have this also a contribution like this. Now you will see that is in this area, they are overlapping, where the solicitation is bigger than the resistance. So there is always a probability that the structure will fail. It's small, very small, but there is always a probability. So R is the resistance, S is the solicitating force. So if you take the difference between it, then you know how safe, between brackets, your structure is. We call it the variable Z. It's the difference between resistance and solicitating. So if you now take the probability of Z, you have a mean and a standard deviation. And now you will see that the reliability index, the beta factor that we talked previously about, is nothing more or nothing less than the mean divided by the standard deviation of the z-function. So it's a measure of how much reserve do we have in the structure. It's a measurement of that. So it's just the mean divided by the standard deviation. You can now on the x-axis, you can have the resistance, the y-axis, the load, and you can have now a point, P. In this point, you have the resistance with his distribution. You have a limit, which is alpha beta, alpha times the reliability index, which is indicates an area of spread, of the spread of the value. This is figured here with the different areas. And now you have, this is the factor beta, alpha beta. On the other hand, in the same point, you will have the load, which is also a probabilistic with the mean and a standard deviation, and you also have a beta factor on it. You will see this is the lower bound and this is the higher bound limit. And then you end up with S, with this line, and you end up in P, in the point P. So you will see that it depends on alpha beta and alpha beta of the resistance and the solicitation. In fact, we always wanted the resistance is bigger than the effect of loading, which is evident. But how much bigger do we want it? Do we want it half of it or double it? Normally we say the resistance must be bigger, so at least it should be the same. At least it should be the same. But must it be 10% more, 20% more, or even more than that? We don't know. So to help us, we use statistics. And this is the way we do it, by filling in those numbers. But this method means automatically that the essential point of the method is that the theoretical probability of exceeding a limit state during the design working life is accepted. So in this lecture, we understand now, or you should remember, that the probability of a building under construction that collapsing during his design life is not zero. You will see it here on the surf site collapse of the building in Miami, or you have another example of the parking lot in Eindhoven in the Netherlands, which collapsed two before the service life was over. So I will see you in the next lecture.